grace and peace to you on this Ash Wednesday. If you picked up a Lent at home bag, this is where you would bring that out and take out all the materials in that bag and in addition, bring a cup of water. If you did not pick up the bag, we invite you still to engage with the rituals and this worship. So if you would gather together a candle, some sand or potting soil, a little bit of water. And if you have one, a glass bead or a piece of sea glass. In this worship service, we're going to consider what it means to be shattered. Let us now enter into a time of worship. Wednesday is a time of naming brokenness. As we enter the season of Lent, we commit to enter also into a season of healing and recovery that requires the naming of what has been shattered as a first step. We take the yoke of responsibility as disciples of Jesus to be the body of Christ, a body of those who need healing and offer healing in the world. The promise of Jesus is that he is with us in our weariness and burdens.
Vessels, holy and whole, broken, needing the
Throughout Lent, we'll be exploring stories of Jesus' healing in the Gospel of Matthew. We'll see how Jesus encouraged people to be open about their lives, no matter how broken. Ash Wednesday developed as a means of speaking the truth of our lives, a time to lay our brokenness before God. Let us pray. Merciful God, we've lived a year of Lent. We've seen places where love has shone through, but also places where we felt shattered. Some of the shattering has been out of our control. Other shattering has sprung from our faults and our failures to love each other fully, to care for the least, to honor your creation, and to stand for what is right and good. As we walk along the shores of uncertainty and struggle, we ask that you meet us here. Help us. Forgive our inertia. Move us to move one step at a time toward greater care. In the silence, we acknowledge our yearning for wholeness. Lent, we'll contemplate the symbol of sea glass. Ordinary bottles are flung into the ocean. Years pass, and then one day, the broken fragments are found on the shore. Shifting currents have rounded its edges, sand has polished its surface, the sun has altered its color. It's a happy surprise to walk along the beach and discover that shattered, broken relic, which time and adversity have transformed into something beautiful. This is the journey we undertake, Jesus attended to those considered ordinary and broken, even those deemed unworthy. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. Glory to God. Amen.
In this moment, we begin to do as the song says and let the healing streams abound. The peace of Christ be with you. Our scripture reading today is from the book of Matthew, chapter 11, verses 28 through 30. Come to me, all that are weary and carrying heavy burdens, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy, and my burden is light. This is the word of God for us, the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Emily spent years as a beloved youth director. But for the 4 years that I've known her, she has longed to be a mother. That's the main thing that she has wanted. She even left her role as a youth director to take another job that was less stressful, hoping that that would do the trick. That would enable her to rest and relax and finally to be a mother, but it didn't work. And then she met with doctors and she did several rounds of IUI and that didn't work either. And she and her husband would say, you know, why did they get to be parents? And we don't get to be parents. And she's young and beautiful and loves children and loves youth. And so people are forever coming up to her and saying, well, when are you going to have children? What's holding you back? When are you going to have kids? And every time she hears that question, she feels shattered. Miriam has an addiction that became a stepping stone into the commercial sex trade. It caused her the loss of her children, her health, her self-worth. And after months and months of working with a pastor and a nonprofit in Eastern North Carolina, last week she relapsed. And her mother said, well, I could have told you that. What did you expect? Miriam feels shattered. What does God do with that sort of pain, that sort of brokenness? How that question gets answered is determined by who you follow, who you ask. In Jesus' time, the rabbis understood it as their job to read the Torah, to interpret the Torah, to help the people who followed them to live a life that as closely as possible resembled what God expected of them. And the rules and regulations that they would form around how you live as God wants, they called that their yoke. So you followed a rabbi and you followed that rabbi's yoke. They would put actions in categories. This is allowed and this isn't. This is bound and this is loosed. So you followed their yoke and that told you how to live your life. But not every yoke is a good yoke. In Matthew 23, Jesus confronts the religious leaders whose yoke he feels is out of step with God. And he says about them, they tie up heavy burdens hard to bear and they place them on the shoulders of the people. When they themselves don't lift a finger to move those burdens. The heavy burdens they lay on the people is their particular interpretation and practice of the law, which makes victims out of the people who most need their care. Take, for example, over the last few weeks, many of you have submitted phrases that capture the ways that our world is shattered, or maybe your life is shattered, or the church is shattered, the community is shattered. And we've taken those words and we've written them on pieces of glass. And some of the words that you have offered up are topics of mental illness, depression, anxiety. And you've lifted up physical ailments as well, things like cancer and Parkinson's. The rabbis whose yoke Jesus was calling out would see those who had mental illness or who were sick, and they would deem them ritually unclean and forbid them from table fellowship. Shattered. In the words that you submitted words about hunger, and you followed up your words by bringing food to Mission Madness, to actually solving the problem of hunger, to lifting that burden from people. But that yoke that Jesus was condemning was a yoke that said, if you're hungry, you still can't gather from the fields on the Sabbath. It was a yoke that took God's gift of Sabbath and wielded it as a weapon against those in need. It excluded those people from fellowship. Who were hungry, shattered. You've named matters of climate, politics, all kind, division, all kinds of things. You labeled those, you sent those words in. And when Jesus was condemning the yoke of certain rabbis, he condemned them because they set aside those things. They failed to teach about justice and mercy. They failed to teach about inequity in the politics, inequity in economics, and the way that the land was being used, God's land was being used. But somehow they never failed to teach about tithing, Jesus said. Their yoke ignored those with the heaviest burdens, the poor, the hungry, the victimized, the oppressed, the sick. All of those people were expected to first heal themselves, to first purify themselves, and then, and only then, were they pure enough to bring themselves before the presence of God, shattered. Jesus' yoke is different. He refuses to place people in binary categories of in or out, or clean or unclean, or normal and abnormal. Instead, he says these words that you heard Danny read just a few moments ago. Come to me, all you that are weary and are carrying heavy burdens, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you. And learn from me, for I'm gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy, and my burden is light. Come to me, Jesus says. Bring your burdens. You don't have to purify yourself. You don't have to solve these yourself. Bring your burdens and lay them before me. Do you hear how this is different from a yoke that says you have to fix it, and only then are you worthy to come into the holy presence of God? And Jesus says, I'll give you rest. It's not that he's saying following him is a life of ease. It's not a gospel of cheap grace. But when he says that, we're thinking of what God said to Moses. When Moses was leading the Israelites through the desert, God said, I will be with you in the wilderness, and I will give you rest. In the same way, Jesus is with us in our wilderness, and he gives us rest. And he lifts the burden of sin off of our shoulders so that we can breathe and know what it means to be forgiven, and we can go out and serve the world. As a forgiven people, we rest in the grace of God. Jesus says, learn from me, for I'm gentle and humble in heart. Learn from me. This stole that I wear is a yoke. That's what it represents. It represents a yoke. And it says, I follow the yoke of Jesus Christ. That my job as a pastor is to interpret that yoke so that all of us in this church can adopt that yoke of Jesus Christ. And we can live as close as possible to the way that Christ expects us to live. If you imagine farm animals that are wearing a yoke and they're yoked together, this is a yoke that says, I am yoked to Jesus Christ. And when Jesus moves right, I move right. And when Jesus moves left, I move left. And when Jesus says, move forward, I move forward because we are yoked together. And he says that his yoke is easy. But that word really means kind. It means good. His yoke is kind and it's good because it brings God's reign of mercy and compassion and justice here on earth now. Often those who feel shattered, they long to be restored to wholeness. If you think about a bottle, they want to be restored to an original state, or they want to be restored to some ideal of what they see. Maybe they look around and their body is shattered, or they were born in a way that doesn't feel whole, and they look around at someone else who looks different than them, and they say, I want to go back to wholeness. I want to be like them. But Scripture calls that putting new wine in old wineskins. And those wineskins burst because they were never meant to be reconstructed in that way. We're, throughout the next 6 weeks, we're going to come up with new ideas of what it means to be whole, of what it means to take these places where we feel shattered and not be restored to that perfect bottle, that original state, but what it means to be transformed into something beautiful, a treasure. And we're using this vision of sea glass, of taken brokenness and being transformed into something new and beautiful. Miriam has a ways to go to be healed. She is still shattered. It's going to take a while. It's going to take the prayers of her community and her pastor and all of these people. It's going to take some really hard work before she gets to that place of beauty again. She needs help to find out again what it means to be whole. Emily, she posted a picture yesterday online, and in that picture was a baby's onesie that reads, "Made with love, prayers, and a little bit of science." After 4 years, 3 IUI procedures, and 1 round of in vitro fertilization, she is pregnant, and she is ecstatic. You might say to yourself, well, now Emily's whole. But I want you to understand, Emily is not this. She's not back to an original state, to old wineskins, because she's had 4 years of anguish, 4 years of desperation, of difficult conversations, of longing. She's in a fair amount of debt, too. So she'll never be this, but what she can be is this. And she will tell you that that's what she is. She is transformed into something beautiful, something she never expected, and she feels whole. The first step toward wholeness is admitting to Jesus that we're shattered. As we enter this season of Lent together, let us commit to taking our own shards of glass and laying them on the altar at the foot of the cross, and to follow the yoke of the one who is gentle and who is humble at heart and who will provide rest for our souls. Amen.
You can soul, make us whole. Let us pray. O Lord, you who weeps, bleeds, cries, and waits for us and because of us, we come before you to make our petitions known. Hear our cries for healing of body, mind, and spirit. We know you're already at work among us, showing us the way to recovery from the infirmities and grief of our time. We pray for those who are shattered by circumstances, tumbled by the forces of life, and washed up on shores from all that feels whole. We pray this day especially for these places of brokenness submitted by our church family. Suicide.
Family estrangement.
Suffering.
Work transitions.
Poverty.
Rituals lost to the pandemic.
Alienated.
Fear.
Academic pressure.
Environmental health.
Survivors of sexual assault.
Mental health.
Sleeplessness.
Pain.
Uncertainty.
Depression.
PTSD.
Anxiety.
Nursing homes.
Mental illness.
Inequality.
Distrust.
Suffering.
Racism.
Grief.
Despair.
Hopelessness.
Loneliness.
Lost friendships.
And frustration.
Hear our Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Ash Wednesday, as the beginning of Lent, developed in the 5th and 6th centuries. But Protestants seldom observed this ritual, but it came back during the 20th century liturgical movement as an important time for reflection. This year, we've become particularly aware of the fragility of life. Even though we can't share ashes in the way that we've become accustomed, we can still engage in a ritual that draws us close to the elements of creation: earth, fire, air, and water, which remind us we're part of creation in all its brokenness and beauty.
We first consider the symbol of earth. The sand upon which our symbol of beach glass washes provides the origins of glass making. Glass is liquefied, heated sand. In a way, beach glass is the epitome of dust to dust, sand to sand. To take it back even further, sand is created by the erosion of mountains and rocks over many years. In sand, we witness the brokenness, the erosion, and weathering of the earth itself. All things become broken, all things transform, and every form we take is holy, whole, and beautiful. I invite you to touch the sand or the soil you have in front of you and to feel its grains, its decomposed nature as we pray. Creator God, as we feel this elemental part of who we are, we remember that we ourselves were made from the dust of the earth. To experience brokenness as part of the human condition. Transform us, O God. Help us recover the beauty of who we are and see the goodness and transformation. Amen.
Next, we consider the symbol of fire. When sand meets the heat of fire, it creates glass. The scriptures and poets throughout the ages have spoken of a refining fire. The heat of fire is destructive, but with intention, care, and tending, refining fire can produce good, useful, and beautiful forms. I invite you to light your candle to center your reflections as we pray. Holy refining fire, as we feel this elemental part of who we are, we remember that you invite us to kindle fires of love for you and for each other. Do not allow the flame of our spirits to lie dormant. Offer us your light and life. Transform us, O God. Help us recover the beauty of who we are and see the goodness in transformation.
Next, we consider the symbol of air. The scriptures tell us God animated humanity with breath. In the first century, around the time of Jesus, the art of glass blowing was introduced. Artisans took molten glass and shaped it by blowing air through a tube, creating an air-filled glass vessel ready for practical or artistic purposes. Breath is part of our creation as holy vessels. It fills our lungs with our first cry and exits with our dying breath. I invite you to close your eyes and become aware of your breath as we pray. Giver of breath and life, you've made air an elemental part of who we are. We give you thanks for the life-giving, automatic, moment-to-moment function of breathing. As we breathe out, letting go of what we don't need, exchange it for the fresh air we do need. Transform us, restore us in our gratitude for breath and for the goodness of transformation.
Finally, we consider the symbol of water. As water meets the sand at the shoreline, we meet the living water that Christ provides. Ancient people combined water with soil to make healing balms to moisten skin, to increase blood flow, and to help us relax. Even today, many places around the world recognize the healing properties of certain types of mud. Since our Lenten focus this year is on healing, I invite you to mix a little bit of water with the sand or the soil that you have with you and create just a little bit of mud. And then place some on the palm of your hand, this part of our body that symbolizes our inner relationships. And use it to just make the sign of the cross on your hand. Or if you choose, you could do this on your forehead as we pray. Healing presence, as we feel this elemental part of who we are, we remember that you created us. You shaped us from dust in the palm of your hand. Someday we'll return to the dust, return to the palm of your hand once again, held and loved. We lament the grittiness of our lives, the need for healing, the difficult and necessary process of transformation. Lord, mark us as your own. Remold us again and again as your people. Let the recognition of our own need break us open yet again for the sake of others and for the sake of the world. And all the people say, Amen. Go into this holy season of Lent with the confidence that though we are shattered, we are held in the palm of God's hand. And let the words of Jesus ring in your ear. I will give you rest. Amen.